Hey everyone, this is Trey and Matt to do commentary once again.
More commentaries.
Our favorite thing in the world to do.
Yeah, we look forward all year to doing this. Talk about some stuff.
Let's talk about ourselves some more.
Well, we wanted to do a nigger episode for for years. I mean, about the word.
That was Matt.
The N-word. I mean, it just seemed like this great subject that obviously has a lot of emotional baggage to it. But it took us a while to.
We had this first scene for a long time.
Yeah, we had this first scene.
This first scene we thought, which is still, it's one of my favorite scenes we've ever done.
And then the Michael Richards thing happened.
Yeah, that's really what it was.
Because that seemed to just grab people, and it seemed to, be one of those things that kind of captured everyone's imagination.
Right.
So we kind of decided.
And it is a little different because he was screaming the N-word at some black people with hatred, and it's a little different when you do it that way. But we wanted to, you know, we had this scene, and they were like, "Well, where can this go? Because it's so funny." And we, you know, like someone forced to say it because they think they're going to make money, and then it being wrong. But then when we came up with the idea that basically we're going to use the N-word, but it's going to apply to white people. So once it became, "Hey, you're that nigger guy," then. that's when we thought we had it. That's when we thought we had a half of a show for sure. And I remember then for the longest time we're like, "Well, this is great and it's a great Randy show, but you know, what can the boys be doing? We always want them to have something to do with the story." And we had this little runner with Token and Stan, but it wasn't really a story. It was just sort of an emotional place to be. And we struggled. And finally, I remember like 3 days before it went on the air, we're like, "Let's have Cartman fight a midget."
Yeah. And that'll be funny.
we don't know how to get there, but basically, as long as we end up with Cartman fighting a midget, it'll be sweet.
Yeah, so that'll be a sweet B story. They kind of don't have anything related to do with each other, although we tried to kind of make it seem like they did. But my favorite part of this episode is kind of the end, which is, it isn't that big of a bang as far as the episode, but we really like the idea of if there was a word as kind of hateful as the N-word is applies to black people, if one of those apply, if there was a word like that against white people would make it illegal.
Right.
And so I really like that ending where it's just like two words completely innocuous on their own, nigger and guy, but put together.
They form words of hate.
Words of hate, and everyone's like, "Yeah, pretty much." I think that was a, I don't know if that's a message, but I thought it was funny.
Yeah. I remember we based the, to get back to the midget for a minute, we based the midget on that. Those guys, there used to be those commercials with those two rich midget guys. I'm sorry, little people. And they were rich little people.
Yeah, what were those?
They had suits, and they walked around in their little suits.
Yeah, what was that?
And they tried to get you to buy into their, like...
Was it a money-making thing?
Yeah, it was like a money-making
thing. Or something?
And it was like one of those typical things where you got the guy, you know, like that one with the Chinese guy. It's like, "Look at my great boat, and look at all the beautiful women I hang out with now." And it's like they were doing the same thing, like walking around in suits going, "You could be super rich too." And it's like, "Dude, yeah, you're a midget." I don't know.
Or is this a skit, or is this real?
Yes, this is a comedy show. Certainly meaning no offense to little people out there. That was just and then we couldn't decide if Cartman fought the midget, if he should win or lose.
I remember too, another thing we talked about with this episode was that we really had, like, when you watch that YouTube clip of Michael Richards, you're like, "Oh man, like, not only are you insane and stepped in it, but like, you really got some problems."
Yeah.
But then it was like, when we really started to hate him was when he went and apologized to Jesse Jackson.
Yeah, that's right.
That was like, you know what, now Michael Richards, now you just have to fuck off.
Yeah.
Like, he went on the Jesse Jackson,
and I think
"Let me
it
kiss
was,
your ass" fucking
I think
tour.
It was Vernon's line, because I think, remember we were talking to Vern about one of our guys that had been a writer for a long time on the show, and he's black, or at least he thinks he is, and he is black, and he said he was the one that said Jesse. He was mad at that too, because he's like, "Jesse Jackson, not the ambassador of black people."
Yeah, the emperor of all black people. Yeah, but to a white person who hasn't really thought about it, I think, like, "Well, I'll go apologize to Jesse Jackson, and then it'll be okay," which is what Randy thinks. It's like, "Okay, good, now I can do that." And all Jesse Jackson did with Michael Richards was take him around the country and kind of rip on him for like a good year.
Yeah.
Like, just gonna take you around for a year and rip on you.
Yeah.
Well, with that, I guess we'll talk about another episode.
Yeah, let's go on. Let's move on.
Okay.
This picture I like to call the PA.
So this episode, Cartman Sucks, is another thing that we sort of had. We had one idea for a long time. It actually goes all the way back to, I don't know what season it was, but years ago when we did the show about Aspen and skiing. We actually had a scene in there where, because part of that show, Cartman's kind of messing with Butters while he sleeps. And we had this whole scene where where that story went was that while they were in Aspen, Carmen's like, you guys, I did the ultimate. While Butters was asleep, I put my dick in his mouth and took a picture. And they're like, dude, he's like, yeah, and that makes Butters seem gay. And it's like, no, it makes you seem gay. And so we had that whole scene in that, and then it ended up, there ended up being so much more in that show, and it became so much more a parody of the old 80s ski movies that it didn't fit in there anymore. So we cut the whole scene out. And so it just sort of sat there for a long time, and finally we got to this season of shows, and we brought that idea up again and said, remember that scene was really funny, and we had to cut it. And so we started talking about it some more and saying, well, maybe we could just start a show that way, and then, you know, instead of just sort of saying in passing, that makes you look gay, we just have Kyle say, that makes you gay, period. So that Cartman is like, you know, and then there was all these other ideas. Okay, well, now Cartman's going to try not to be gay. He's going to try all this stuff. But then we thought, no, let's just make it be about trying to get the picture back from Kyle.
I remember we had a big problem doing this stuff. We couldn't decide whether to go to the re-education camp, or what was going to be the other?
Well, that was going to be one scene. We came up with a thing that's like, okay,
it could have been just one scene. Like, yeah, he goes to the re-education camp, it doesn't work.
Remember,
and it's
Butters'
over.
Butters' dad was going to come in and see Butters with Cartman's dick in his mouth, and then freak out, and then try all these different things. Like, first he was going to take him to a Christian gay camp,
right,
and that wasn't going to work.
He was going to get him a date.
Then he was going to take him to Tijuana, remember?
Yeah, Tijuana.
And he was finally going to take... Butters' dad was going to take Butters to Tijuana and try to get him laid. And it was going to be this whole farcical thing. And then
Ray fucks a donkey instead.
Yeah. Yeah.
A donkey show. They're going to end up at a donkey show.
But I remember then it ended up... We sort of got to the camp, and we kind of, oh, this is kind of fun. Because remember, he was going to get to the camp, and then we actually had it animated at first where all the camp kids were like... Because he says, oh, a camp full of gay children trying to be straight. That sounds like a good idea. And then you cut to all the kids, and they're like,
it's
some fresh meat. And they were having, like, raves every night, and they were just like, these little gay kids that are super stoked to be at camp, because they all get to go there and just fuck each other all summer.
But also, like, a bunch of outcast gay kids, and then they get to go all be together. Yeah. Like, they're not going to suppress their homosexuality. They're going to find it.
Yeah.
You know, they're really going to discover themselves.
And so then Butters' dad was going to walk in during this big rave where they're all on his, like, trying to gangbang Butters and everything. And he was just like, oh, now I got to get my son laid. So that sounds funny too. But then we got to the camp, and we really liked the idea too of, like,
well, we came up with the idea of that little kid who was really troubled by it. And that seems such a better emotional story than we were going to go gay gangbang than gay donkey show.
Right.
It seemed funnier to have, like, an actual story.
And he seemed like he's kind of a cool character. And really, it's just, I'm just doing Stan's voice while biting my fingernails. it's basically the same thing. But you know, we came up with that little runner, and then the whole thing about, the whole thing about the kid wanting to kill accountability buddy.
Yeah, accountability buddy. And the cool thing is, like, Butters just gives him a speech in the end that he doesn't even really know what he's saying, but it saves him. This is a good scene.
Yeah, this is one of my favorites. This is one of those where we're, like, trying to tell Comedy Central. They're like, what is this? Because it was one of the early scenes before they knew the context of the rest of the show. They're like, what the hell is going on? We're like, no, it all makes sense in a minute. And we kind of just wore them down, because at first there was actually, and I don't know if you still can, I'm waiting to see. Yeah, we had a little tiny penis on Cartman, and they're like, you can't have the little penis. And I was like, I guess it makes sense, because he wouldn't have a little boner anyway.
Yeah, because he does have a little boner. He doesn't know what he's doing.
Yeah. So anyway, I'm sure you've heard enough about that episode, so we'll move on, even though we'd like to do more on this one.
Butters, how long have you been doing stuff like this?
Like what?
Don't lie to me, Butters!
This episode is Lice Capades, which I think it basically started because I think you came in one day and was just like, what if we did an episode where you just had the part where you just wanted to zoom into the kid's hair?
Right.
Like,
because
there's an old Warner Brothers cartoon that's kind of like,
where they have fleas on a dog.
They have fleas on a dog, right? Yeah.
But,
we started talking about that too.
We actually started this show, we started animating it where the lice didn't have little voices, because I wanted to try to do it all visually. And so we were telling the whole story, and the lice never talked.
Or they were just going to go,
yeah, they just kind of made little, like, cute little sounds. And, of course, it ended up being just kind of really cute and not South Park. So it was like, then we're like, I remember we actually had it that way, because this is all new animation. So this was one of those really tough shows where on Thursday we said, hey, we're going to do this whole colony of lice, and the animators all freaked out. But as they're drawing it all and we're starting to see it, it gets to be Saturday before the show airs, and we're watching these little lice, and they're not talking, and they're not—they're just being cute, and it's kind of hard to get what's going on. And
mean me.
And so it was until Saturday that we were like, we got the idea of like, what if we just did Bruckheimer Lice?
Yeah, what if they just had that voice?
So we just give them sort of over the top lines and have lice that act way too much. And so it's one of those things we went back and forth because we're like, well, we don't do that very much in South Park where we break that wall and have animals talk. But once we tried it in one scene, and once I saw the main lice with sideburns on his head, I was like, oh, we're doing this way.
Yeah, I can't remember what else we talked about the eco disaster warrior is now the new kind of hero in movies.
Yeah,
the guy who's like, you're killing the earth.
It used to be disaster movies, and now it's eco disaster.
But there's always the eco disaster hero.
Yeah,
which is basically he knows before anybody, and he's like, you know, you're tearing it all down, you're killing it all.
Yeah,
and that's almost every movie now is eco disaster and the hero who knows about it and tries to save it. What are we doing this?
Well, we did that. We had that idea to do that scene from The Thing.
Oh yeah, that's in this movie.
Where that? Because it's really kind of cool. The fun. This I really like this episode because at the end, once you learn that actually everyone had lice the entire time, and we were just following, we were just kind of tracking one of the kids. Once you know that, it's kind of cool to watch how everyone's behaving, because in fact most kids are doing exactly what you would expect. Like Cartman's setting up this elaborate thing plan with a thing that obviously shouldn't work just to frame Kenny.
We also, there was a while where we had the first couple of scenes of this, and we talked a bit about the idea that instead of he and his family, it's kind of a post-apocalyptic, that we would start apocalyptically, like it's like something's already happened.
Right.
He does the shampoo, and then they try to, and they make a little spaceship, remember? Or a little like thing, and they leap to another world, and then they get to another kid's hair, and then they start a colony. We had talked about all that stuff and all
that stuff. Because that's what lice really do. They really jump from one head to another.
They jump.
To save themselves.
And they really are basically crabs.
Yeah.
They're the same thing as genital crabs or whatever those are.
I wouldn't know anything about that.
That we've all gotten tons and tons of times.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Cool, let's move on to the next episode.
But now, think of the world as a living being.
So this is the Snuke. This is our 24 show, basically. Our 24 parody.
Yeah. My first experience with 24 was, I think, season 5. That's what, the one, right? That's so good.
The one with the president.
Yeah, the one with the president and his wife, and the bad guy president and his wife. That was the first, and I got the DVDs, which thank God, because 24, it's like Lost and some of these other shows where, like, I can't imagine watching those on TV, because there's just some episodes where you get to the end and you're like, I have to know what happens after this. And that's what they're so good. That's why the writers are so skilled at what they're doing. But, you know, watching it on DVD, it would just be tons of nights of sitting there and going, oh, I'm going to watch an episode of 24. And then 3 hours later, I'm like, oh man, it's 3 a.m. I gotta go to bed. I'm not going out tonight. I'm just gonna stay home, get to bed early, and watch some 24. And then I end up sitting there drinking and watching 24 till 5 a.m. and being totally hungover in the morning. But I think that definitely that season. I mean, I've seen some of the other seasons now too, and you know, it's all pretty good. But that season 5.
Yeah. That's the one with Nixonian president, that was great. That stuff in the White House.
Watch that thing straight through.
And his wife, whatever that actress's name was, she was amazing. Yeah, that's kind of the only season I've really watched, and I thought, especially that part of it was kind of unbelievable.
Yeah.
And we figured out that, I remember doing this episode, we figured out how to make Cartman sound like Jack Bauer, which was to whisper.
Yeah.
He whispers really loud. He's always out of breath.
If he's been sitting at a table for 2 hours, which of course never happens, but if he's supposed to have been sitting at a table even for 20 minutes, and he starts talking to someone, he's always going to go, listen, we have to know where this is going to right now. Even if he's trying to talk to someone across the room.
Right. A lot of times he's trying to get somebody to say, you tell me the door code. And then they go, no. And he goes, you will tell me the door code. And then they tell him the door code.
You will tell me the door code.
And then they tell him.
Yeah.
Like if he breathes hard enough,
he blows a kneecap off and they go. Yeah.
And he's he tortures. It's like, tell me the door code. No. You must tell me the door code. No. And then he rips out an electrical cord and tortures them until they tell him the door code.
I'm pretty sure, though, that for this...
He just loves torture.
I think
Jack
for
Bauer.
This episode, we actually had the idea of Hillary Clinton with a nuclear device up her sniz before we even thought to put it in 24 terms.
I think we just had the term sniz and then snook, and we just thought that was funny.
Yeah, we just knew that we wanted to have a snook in her.
We also had this whole thing we really didn't do in this episode, but we were going to do this whole storyline with these guys called Hill Dogs. They basically go around and they dress up like those Cleveland Dog Pound guys. Yeah. But
you can see them in here.
Oh, they are in one. Yeah, they're just a little bit.
Yeah, but they don't.
We were going to make that a big storyline, how the Hill Dogs always fall, hoping that we would now have. We should have done that.
Yeah.
We should
so have that done people it. Would now, while Hillary campaigns, there would always be a bunch of Hill Dogs there and she'd be all bummed out. She was going, Hill Dog, Hill Dog, Hill Dog. Because she'd be so confused. Like, are they supporting her? Are they making fun of her?
It's kind of a bummer, but they're there, so you kind of have to thank them. But we didn't end up doing this to really. Yeah.
But we did actually a really cool thing was after this episode, we got word that the 24 crew who was shooting a new season had all gathered in their big what do they call it, CTU, right? Yeah, CTU set where they've got just tons of monitors and the whole cast and crew set and watched the episode. And they were so stoked that we got, like a week later, we got in the mail a prop,
the suitcase nuke
from their episode. So we put that in glass, and now we've got one of the props from 24.
Yeah, we have a suitcase nuke from 24 in our office.
Pretty sweet.
That was pretty cool. That was pretty much the best part of the whole thing, getting it.
Yeah, nuke. It's always about getting stuff.
And then, of course, within the same like months or whatever, or before us or after, I don't know, but Simpsons did a 24 episode too.
Yeah.
Of course, I'm just like, God damn it. And they probably were thinking, God damn it.
Yeah.
But it was like 24 was like, I don't know if we did. We beat it to it, or they do it.
No, remember we did. They did. Theirs didn't come out for like 3 months.
But they were working on it. I mean, it's like that same thing where it's like it's 24 is such a huge show that it's like an obvious idea for anybody to parody.
Right, right.
You know.
But I don't think they had a nuclear device up Hillary Clinton's sniz.
No, I think I don't know what theirs was.
Pretty sure they didn't do that. All right, let's move on.
Is the threat credible?
In my Easter bonnet.
So this is the Fantastic Easter special, which is honestly maybe in my top 5 favorite episodes ever. I say that a lot, it's not only about the episode, but it's like so much I remember making them, and there's certain episodes, and there's, believe me, they're very few and far between, but there's some episodes where we come in on Thursday and we're like, all right, what are we doing this week? And you come up, something works, and it just starts working, and it just keeps working, and you're just so stoked, because it all kind of falls together. And I remember that I actually remember we were outside in the sun doing a writer's meeting, which we never do because it's too, you know, too late. We normally have to sit in our dark office and work. But we went into our dark office and started talking about this idea and started hitting on some things. We're like, oh, that's really funny. Oh, yeah, that could be really cool. And like, let's go outside. And it was like spring was coming, and, you know, it was just like, and it was warm. And I remember that it just kind of kept flowing, all the ideas, and it was just one of those rare shows where actually on Thursday I kind of knew where it was all headed and felt like, man, I could write like half of this show right now, and sat down and wrote a bunch of it. And that's rare when that happens, but when it does, it's really wonderful.
I remember if anything we had to... We always, like, conspiracy shows and that kind of stuff, it always sounds more, the conspiracy part of it is so much more fun to talk about than to actually work into a story.
Yeah.
And we had to kind of, we had to kind of make that conspiracy part where you found out that the whole kind of secret behind the Hair Club for Men, that it was a, that, I mean, we boiled it down to its, like, essential elements, but, like, we spent way too much time talking about this intricate conspiracy that would take years and years to, you know, explain in a show.
Because we had talked for a long time about doing a Da Vinci Code show. And actually, we had the idea for a while of doing a Easter Da Vinci Code. Like, cause
we had that idea that there was some, that the eggs, because that's that thing of, like, why eggs?
Yeah.
And it's, like, kind of answering that question.
Why eggs? Why a bunny? Why does he hide the eggs? Why does he hide the eggs? You know, and so we started doing lots of stuff and researching, you know, all about where, you know, all these things came from, and then watching the Da Vinci Code, unfortunately, a couple of times, and be like, wow, this is terrible. But we're able to learn from it, because we're like, all right, well, basically, just kind of like the book, they're trying to hide the fact that everyone's just basically standing around talking, and then suddenly they're running from something, and then they're all standing around talking again.
And that's all they do.
So it's like that in the book, it kind of works because that's okay in a book, but in a movie, that's pretty hard, and in a TV show, that's hard. So we had that, you know, this scene in this where we reveal the whole thing about Peter, Cottontail, and Jesus, and that Da Vinci scene used to be probably 3 times longer.
Yeah,
than
way
it is long.
Way, way more stuff.
Because you think you need to explain it and explain it and explain it, and then you just start cutting it and cutting it and cutting it, and you realize
it's not that hard to
get. Yeah, it's not hard to get.
And the other thing is, in this episode, we decided to make the bad guy that Bill Donahue guy.
Yeah, that's right.
This guy who runs this. he and about four of his friends run this thing called the Catholic League, which is just about the stupid. It's just this, like,
all it really is
it's just like him and four friends, and they bitch about television.
Yeah, and we actually didn't even want to give him the credit of, like, being on the show, but and we went back and forth with that, but then it was just like, oh, let's just do it. But the funny thing is about that, the Bill Donahue, really all he is when someone wants to write a story, like when we did the Bloody Mary episode, and someone wants to write a story, oh my God, South Park did this, and is it okay? You know, because even CNN or anyone, when they do a story about us, they have to, like, find that other side, you know, because they're saying, like, when we did the Tom Cruise thing, CNN, obviously, if you watch what they did, thought it was really sweet, and they're sitting there going, but they have to, they can't go, oh, so awesome what they did, so they have to go, is it okay to do that? Let's bring on so-and-so. So yeah, they got to find someone to bring on that can be like, no, it's terrible, and so they always go to Bill Donahue, because he's the only guy that'll go on TV and be like, no, get these guys. And it's for anything. You see, like, we're friends with Penn and Teller, and, like, anytime they, it's just like, they're like, oh, you mean Bill Donahue? Like, he's
that,
always
that
for that.
Fucking
it's always
asshole.
The, it's always that
he's
guy.
Always that guy. And it's like the press, he has no authority. He is this kind of nobody guy.
Yeah.
He's just shameless enough and douchey enough to go on TV and bitch about it. So CNN and Fox and those places, they get him to come on. So yeah, it seems like, one, it seems like there's the other side, but also, it also, like, gives, it's like, it makes it sound like Catholics out there are really up in arms over this,
yeah,
and they're not.
Is we have friends that are Catholic, and in fact, Ann Garofino, who's one of the producers on the show, is like a very devout Catholic, and we get along, and everything's great. And she, you know, she and she, people like Bill Donahue really piss her off because she's like, that guy doesn't. It's like the Jesse Jackson thing again. It's like that guy does not speak for Catholics.
He's not the Emperor of Catholics. The Pope is,
but he likes to think he's the Emperor of Catholics. So, so we had him killed by Jesus. That's enough for that. When my son would be brought into the society. So this is our D-Yikes episode. I don't really like this episode that much.
This kind of started by wanting to make fun of 300.
No, it didn't.
Remember
at the start, we had the whole idea about it started with Cartman or Garrison's going to become a lesbian. Because we've been following this track.
Are you sure that? Is that where we started?
Because that's when we came up at Lake Tahoe.
Right.
And so we wanted to follow. We knew that we slowly wanted to bring Garrison back to being a man, but before we wanted to make him a man, we decided we wanted to make him a lesbian. And so, you know, it was just more of his sexual troubledness. And so, there's a lot of that. I mean, there's stuff in this that I like, but the thing is that he you know, going through and then finding a gay woman's bar, and then of course taking ownership of that and feeling like that's his home and that's, you know, always been his home and stuff like that.
And they want to close down our home.
Yeah. And this is, of course, for those of you who follow these commentaries a lot, this is one of the quote-unquote banked shows, which, as you know, it always ends up being really hard to do because unlike what I was just talking about, a show that you kind of hit on something and it's just going and you got this momentum and you come up with it on Thursday and you're just crank and it's all coming and fresh and all that stuff, we do these shows where we try to finish half of it ahead of time and then do the rest of it somewhere later in the run. So just because doing these are so hard and stressful that by the time we get to the fifth week or so, we just want an extra 6 hours of sleep at some point, and this kind of lets us do that. But we kind of stopped doing it, and actually this was sort of the last one we did because it was the same thing where we picked up an episode and it had a lot of this stuff in it. It had all the him going, meeting a woman, kissing her and scissoring and all that stuff.
And
knowing,
then 300 came out in the meantime.
Yeah, and so then we got to the week and we're like, okay, well, where do we go with this now? And in the meantime, I think 300 had come out. Because it had only been out for like a week.
It had been out for a week, and then a couple of our friends had seen it, and they really liked it, and so they drugged me to do it.
Yeah,
and I've never hated a movie quite as much as that movie.
I don't want to watch a two-hour-long music video.
Yeah, that actually, what's funny is like when we do a show, or many people do this. Like, it's just one method we use is you write out the beats or the scenes on note cards. Like, here's what happens. You know, like Garrison starts this thing. He has the kids write an essay because of that. They go get these day worker guys to write their essay. You know what I mean? You have this kind of flow and these different beats that this leads to that, this leads to that. But then this happens, so then you have to do this. And this kind of like logical flowchart of a show. 300 has it. I think if you were to beat that movie out, it would be like five beats.
Yeah.
It would be like they get pissed off at that guy. A bunch of people, they're gonna come and kill them. So then they go off, and then they battle, and then they battle, and then they battle. And then the only thing that actually happens in the movie is the humpback betrays them, and then they battle and die.
Yeah.
That's it. Nothing actually happens in that movie.
The hero's journey that we're on is that the hero is badass, and then he's badass, and then he's badass, and then he's badass, and then he dies.
And then he dies.
That's not the hero's journey. That's bad writing.
That's the stupidest movie.
And then everyone's like, well, they're just making a comic book look sweet. And it's like, okay, but why don't you throw a little story in there so that I can sit there for 2 hours.
And then his wife is raped kind of by some guy, and then she gives a speech that's inconsequential and doesn't matter.
Yeah.
If they took all the slow-mo out, the movie would be 37 minutes long.
Yeah.
And if they kind of made it make sense.
You know what the perfect example is? I think it's by the same director that did Night of the Living Dead or Return of the Living, whatever.
The new one, Dawn of the Dead.
Dawn of the Dead, yeah. The one where they're in the shopping mall that was the remake of the
old. Which is amazing.
That movie is amazing. And it's the same thing. I mean, it's like visually, it's super cool.
And we use that movie for the homeless movie.
Yeah. And it's super stylized, super awesome. And there's characters in it, and they go through changes, and they make different decisions, and it's just, so that's why I thought, I was like, oh, 300 is going to be amazing, because that guy knows what he's doing. Turns out, I don't know whether he got lucky the first time or what. I think he had a better writer on the first movie,
maybe
obviously.
I was so excited for that. The trailer for 300 is amazing. And that's the other thing, I'm going to say it right now, I don't even think it looks that cool.
I don't either.
I think it looks cheap and shitty. Yeah. I'm going to say that.
Totally agree.
I'm going to say that publicly for the first time. I think 300 looks like it was made. It's like, oh, it was made on a soundstage in Montreal with 30 people. It's like, you can tell. It looks like shit, and it's stupid.
See, look at our stuff. This looks way better.
Yeah. This is real quality right here.
All right, let's move on. Just fun.
All right, this time.
Speaking of the homeless episode.
Here it is. So I think we used that director's other good movie.
Yeah.
Dawn of the Dead, which is amazing.
But of course, that was a remake of another movie. But we went back and
it's still good. I mean, still great. Yeah,
that. I don't think we can stress it enough. That movie rules. If you haven't seen that movie, the new Dawn of the Dead, we're in the shopping mall. I've seriously probably watched it.
The shopping mall. I think it is Dawn of the Dead.
Where I've seriously probably seen it 25 times or more because it's one of those movies. Anytime it's on, I just oh, here it is. I watch it. Just like Scarface. If it's on, you got to keep watching it. But this episode, we had the idea of like, we just sort of had the joke of like, imagine if the homeless started getting so much money that they were able to rent, and then the homeless would start buying homes, and then you wouldn't even know if a homeless person was living in the house next to you. Obviously, that makes no sense, but we thought that was a funny idea, and then it slowly, this was the last show of that run, so I'm sure it was very difficult to do because we're pretty tired of this.
We talk about that. The thing about homeless being of like, it's just such an unsolvable problem. Like, it seems like that thing where if like you live in a place that has a homeless problem, you want to help them because like they're human beings and you want to help. But you feel like the more you help them, if you want to be really, if you have like, oh, we have these 10 homeless people here, you know what? We can all band together and do something and like help them out.
Yeah.
Then like secretly through some weird, well, not secretly, but like some of like other homeless people find out through the grapevine, and then they all move there, and then you have more of a homeless problem. So it's like that weird thing where like, and if you want to, you know, if you're cruel to people, you know, you don't want to do that either. So it's just it's really, we don't like give a solution as much as just kind of talk about just how frustrating that problem is and how kind of unsolvable it is, no matter what your point of view is on it.
Because obviously we live where we live now, we're close to like Santa Monica, who prides themselves on being super nice to the homeless. But if you ever walk around Santa Monica, it sucks.
There's all these homeless people and it stinks.
Not a lot. There's tons. Right. And like you can't even walk along this. There's supposed to be this beautiful park along the promenade, and it's just a homeless camp now. And all the Santa Monica, you know, the people that are like, well, where else are they going to do? At least we're cool to them. It's like, yeah, I guess, but, you know, your city fucking sucks ass. And
no, so, places like, you know, I don't think Manhattan Beach is that cool of a place, but they don't have any homeless people.
Yeah,
or they have some, but it's not like Santa Monica. And I live in Venice, which has its share.
And there's actually in the last thing we do a song where they're doing California loves to party, but we're doing about the homeless, and Cartman actually sings right by Matt's house, which is like, because it's kind of true, there's a bunch of homeless right by Matt's. There's not many homeless by me because I'm in Brentwood.
So I'll tell a story. I'm going to tell a story that happened to me last night so no one thinks that like we're just unduly cruel to the homeless in this episode. I was walking to dinner last night, and I watched a little like 12-year-old kid, couple kids, there's this homeless guy sleeping on the street, throw a rock at a homeless person, like, and hit him sitting on the ground. And he was just like, rrr, like it didn't hurt him that bad or anything. And I chased down the kids and I bitched him out. So there you go.
So see?
I'm a noble.
Okay.
Yeah, see? This show's okay.
This is the story we should tell. Because
I thought that was fucking lame.
There was a point where Matt and I were before South Park, obviously, we were just in LA, and we had this studio apartment that was like $400 a month, and it was like just a room and a kitchen.
It was right on an on-ramp to the 405.
Futon and Matt slept on his dirty clothes, but it was on the on-ramp to the 405, and so you could, as you looked out the window, you just saw the on-ramp, you just saw cars going by. And there was always a homeless dude out there with a sign that said, you know, whatever it always says.
It was like a dollar. Give me a dollar.
And it was like, vet, please help me out, and da-da-da-da. But the fact is, he's out there with this sign, and it says, you know, help me out, da-da-da-da. And then we would, because we were bored, we would sit there and watch him, and a guy would come, take his sign, and they would hand him his sign, and then take his place, and the other guy would leave.
And he'd sit out there for about an hour, and we watched them make, $25 or $30 an hour.
Yeah.
They made way more money than we did. We were just like, we just sat there.
We would sit there and count how much money they made.
You could say, if they're $1, because they were handing them bills, and you sit there and go, ah, he made about $20, $25 an hour.
$25 an hour.
And he would sit out there for 2 or 3 hours, and then another guy would come, and he would give him the sign, and he would sometimes give him his ratty jacket, and then they would trade off.
But remember, there was like five guys total, and there was a woman too. And then we would go down, when we walked down the block to get a donut from 7-Eleven, they would all be there as a group, hanging out. It's like, they would just, one of them would go take turns and go make their money, and it's just kind of like...
Except for you shouldn't throw rocks at them.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on.
So here we are with our Tourette's episode.
This was the first episode of the fall run.
Yeah. It wasn't actually designed that way. It was designed to be a banked episode. But we sort of got into it, and then we were like, we would send some of the scenes to Comedy Central, and they're like, so what are you going to do? Like, and the idea was, well, maybe we can do this as a special show that will air at like midnight. And it went through all these different things. Like, this will be a special episode because we can't obviously bleep it, because then obviously it's just a bunch of bleeps. And the whole joke is like, I have Tourette's now, I can say whatever I want. And then if it was just a bunch of bleeps, it probably wouldn't have been that funny. So.
Should have made this into a movie.
Yeah.
We could have just said whatever. We basically did anyway.
Yeah.
Comedy Central let us say almost whatever we wanted.
It really came down to it came down to phone calls of like, all right, you can have five cocks, you know, two shits.
Shits, yeah.
What, you know, and it was just like, and it was still like, but no fuck. And it's like, there's stuff in here he says that's way worse than saying fuck.
Yeah. It's just the magic word, though. They just can't say fucker. Advertisers, I guess, will have a fit. I don't know. I think in episodes like this, they call ahead to the advertisers and they say, we're going to do this thing. Are you okay with it? And I think they're always okay with it. So I don't know.
There's always a different thing. You know, it's the same with South Park, and it's always with a lot of stuff like this. It's you're always surprised by how the way it looks on paper. And as soon as there's this thing we get away with because it's these dumb, shitty cutouts.
Yeah.
That a lot of things that seem like they're just going to be so hardcore and so brutal, as soon as you see it done by shitty cutouts, it makes it all just silly. And that's why a lot of times we'll send Comedy Central, the animatic. So it's just basically drawings and the dialogue. And at that point, they'll be like, oh, no, I don't know. And Anna always says something like, well, wait till you see it. And then a lot of times they'll see it animated and be like, oh, yeah, I guess it's not that bad. For some reason, it's just this magical thing.
Plus, they've already read it, so they've already...
Yeah, it seems like a little less hardcore.
They're not as surprised by it. The other thing is, in this episode, is we kind of ripped on Chris Hansen.
Yeah, because that was all going down right about that time.
That guy shot himself. To Catch a Predator, that show.
Yeah, because we like To Catch a Predator just as much as anyone. But you know, there were once it got super popular, and it was so obvious they were overstepping their bounds, and they were basically, you know, like becoming the police force, and that's obviously a super scary thing.
Yeah, we like To Catch a Predator. We like the Constitution more.
Yeah,
we're kind of weird like that. We don't think Chris Hansen should be working with the cops to try to bust people to make good television.
If you haven't seen the video of that going down, when that guy shot himself and what happened leading up to that, you got to check it out, because it's so wrong. And Chris Hansen is literally ordering the police around because they're trying to get the best show.
Right.
But this is obviously before they know he's going to kill himself, obviously, but they've all stormed his house. The guy knows he's busted, and the guy's in there, and Chris Hansen's out there telling the police what to do.
Like, where to get it so he can get a good shot.
Yeah.
And the police
are going along because they're on TV. They're like, okay, you know, and everything. And then the guy kills himself. And I assume Chris Hansen is still working, but he shouldn't be. I mean, that should be really about the worst offense you can possibly do.
You should lose. He should have lost his reporter's license, his journalist license, a long time ago. Had it revoked and thrown away. I don't think they have one of those, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But That shit can fuck off. Yeah. Even though, when you watch that show, you can't take your eyes off of it.
Yeah.
And there are some genuine fucking pervy guys.
No, because
on there.
It's like, wow, this is like something I've never seen. And it's like, well, that's because it's illegal and people can't do it.
That's the other way. But they posit it as, and it kind of seems like when you first see it, it's like we're doing a public service. We're taking these pervs off the street, and it's like, well, that's good.
But that's not your job. That's law enforcement's job.
And then they're selling, you know, Nissan Sentra commercials in the middle of it, and it just is. It's just a bad. Coalition of forces: Nissan Sentra, Budweiser, Chris Hansen, and the fucking Texas police.
Yeah.
All working together to fuck
honey
you
bunches
over.
Of oats. Working together to catch
pervs in a funny, cool way.
All right.
I need to have a moment alone with my good friend Kyle. Ass cheeks.
This episode's called "More Crap," starring Randy.
Yeah, because we thought let's make some more crap.
And this episode, as a cynic could maybe look at and go, you know what, this is just like a one, really, you're going to do a whole episode about Randy taking a big shit? And you know what? I love this episode.
I actually love this episode.
I think this episode is sweet.
And it's a lot of, we got a lot of negative feedback. It was one of those polarizing episodes. We got, you know, tons of bad feedback on it, and then tons of people going, that was rad. And it's just basically... There's certain episodes we do that, like, you're either on the train or you're off the train. And if you're off the train, it's going to really piss you off. And you're just no getting back on it. And
there's
so,
a certain moment in this episode. I'm trying to figure out when it is. Here's the Emmy thing.
Yeah, we did this. Some people thought, well, did comedy? Was this just bad timing? But we were, like, making fun of ourselves because we had just won the Emmy.
For World of Warcraft.
And so we had just gotten the Emmy and we were like, really, we deserve Emmys? And then so we like decided to put the Emmy award winning thing right under Randy Tynan, and then we do it again a couple times,
which means I guess we'll never win another Emmy.
Yeah, we'll probably never win another Emmy again, but we thought it was
funny. It was worth a joke.
Yeah,
so but I mean,
jokes are more important than Emmys.
There is a certain moment, I don't know, maybe he's now, I think it's when you get maybe when he has it out and he has the little spray bottle.
Yeah,
that's probably the moment where in this episode you're like, okay, fuck you, you're really gonna do this for a whole episode. I mean, there's that moment when you're gonna realize as viewing this that. And then that moment, I think, would probably about half the people would just kind of go, I'm not watching this shit.
But it's also definitely like a lot of, like, the kids didn't get, you know, it's like, we don't read a lot of the internet feedback because it's usually people under the age of 13. But it's also the thing, you know, they all hated it and women hated it because you kind of got to be a grown man, probably more than 30 before you really understand what it's like to be really proud of the giant crap you just took.
I've been proud of shit. So I don't know. I think I've been proud of shit since college.
My dad, who, you know, this show's obviously is based, Randy Marsh is based on, was super stoked on this episode. He thought it was the funniest thing he'd ever seen because he could just completely relate. So, and then there's obviously, there's the, you know, plot-wise, emotionally, it had to do with this great movie we saw, King of Kong, which was a documentary about championship Donkey Kong playing. And so there are just, and that's an amazing fan. It's super funny and really well done movie. And so we just wanted to apply that to taking crap.
Yeah, and to Bono. And just that idea of there's this, just why can't Bono leave just something for somebody else to be good at?
Yeah.
He seems to be good at everything. It's like, just leave something for Randy.
So let's buy it for that.
Let's buy it, yeah. So.
No, my brother took a crap once that was enormous.
So then begins Imaginationland, and we've actually, we did commentary on almost this entire, all three parts we already did for Imaginationland DVD, so we'll sort of just hit the highlights here.
We may repeat stuff, or we may totally contradict what we say in that one, too. We may say totally different stuff.
I just remember
that, lying anyway.
I remember kind of emotionally being at the point where we had done the Tourette's, where Cartman had, you know, it was just all about Cartman swearing, and then we did more crap, was about a giant shit, and then... So it started becoming this thing. We were starting to, you know, hear that people were going, oh, you guys are just doing scatological humor now. You know, this is it. You guys. And so we're like, we felt kind of like, yeah, I guess those were two big kind of scatological shows in a row. And it's like, it's time to bring out the big guns and do something a lot more, you know, a bigger sort of satire and parody. And so we had had this idea to do terrorist bombing our imaginations. We'd had that idea for a long time.
Yeah.
And we just didn't quite know how to do it, how to pull it off. And it also sounded like a big enough idea that we're like, oh, maybe it could be the next movie if we ever wanted to do a movie again. So we kind of always kept it in our back pocket. And then I remember this, actually, we sat down and said, let's just do the Imaginationland show and we'll just do it as one episode. And so we were actually going to do this whole thing.
Yeah.
We started on a Thursday of that week. We just started Thursday and Friday doing scenes and being like, okay, it's going to be one episode. They're going to go. Like, all this stuff that happens over three episodes was going to happen in one. It would have been horrible because nothing would have gotten the time it needed. And
been terrible.
So as it went, you know, it got to be Saturday, Sunday. We're like, well, you know what? It's going to be a two-parter. That's cool. Two-parter. And then really by the time...
But still, we talked about even in the second week of... We talked about it. Could still be a two-parter.
Right.
And then we decided to make it three.
Yeah.
So we didn't really know.
Yeah, we didn't really know. But
I love the idea that it's just a leprechaun that goes into Imaginationland. I really like that. Because we tried to think of something more creative than a leprechaun, yeah. But I just like that it's a leprechaun. I think it's something less derivative and more funny. Just like, nope, a leprechaun.
And it is, it turned out cool. I mean, after making the three episodes, on the one hand, we were kind of like, you know, we probably could have taken more time with it and made it into a movie and made things bigger and all that. But on the other hand, writing-wise, I had a really good time doing this because I think some of the best writing to come out of Hollywood these days is the drama TV shows, you know, like the 24s and Lost and things like that that are the big can you leave things kind of hanging and where will you do it since you have to continue next week. And so it was kind of a fun challenge to kind of, especially episode two was the big challenge, to keep all the balls in the air but make it satisfying, have enough twists. And so it was actually, I'm glad we did this as a three-parter.
Yeah, I'm glad now. Because now we can move on to episode two and talk more about it. That's why I'm glad we did it as a TV show.
Previously on Battlestar Galactica.
See, that's actually another, that's another great show. I mean, the Battlestar Galactica and their ability to kind of have something original in each week, so it's sort of not always about the same thing, and yet have these through lines that kind of keep you watching.
It's all about keeping balls up in the air.
Yeah.
And they're really, really good at
it. And that literally happens here, since it's all about Cartman trying to get Kyle to suck his balls.
Wow, really?
He's trying to keep those balls in the air.
Wait a second.
It was actually originally the first episode that aired, the evil characters were supposed to break through and sort of all hell breaks loose with those characters, and then that's where we're going to leave it. And then it got to be Tuesday night, the day before the show went on the air, and it was about 3 in the morning when Frank came into me, the producer, and said, we're not going to make, there's no way, we're like still 100 shots out. We're going to easily be here till 10 a.m., and even then, these shots just, they're not going to make it. We're not going to make air. So I had to... suddenly reimagine, okay, what do we go out on? And so all the part in the first one that ended with the guy going, they are coming, and it just ending on that note, I was actually really bummed out about it because I thought it was just really, I was like, oh, that's, people are going to be bummed out of it. It ends that way. But it actually ended up kind of working because everyone was like, oh, I can't wait to see what comes out.
Yeah, everyone was like, I wonder what's going to come out beyond the wall.
And they were like, oh, we better make this satisfying. So it's basically this shot right here that was going to be in the first episode, and I'm glad we didn't now because it wouldn't have looked nearly that good. It was like, it used to be like 15 characters coming out.
You gotta spend a little more time on it and make it a little bit better. And this stuff too, this was gonna happen at the end of the left.
Yeah, that's right, that all was supposed to happen. But now, we were able to put all this into part two, and so that made that a little easier.
It made it a little better. What else happens in part two?
Part two is the big imagination doorway.
Yeah.
And we had that idea for a long time.
Yeah, it's basically Stargate. We just basically, and then that's why Kurt Russell's in it.
Yeah.
Because we just said, well, we just... No,
everyone knows obviously. We're doing Stargate. We might as well just put Kurt Russell in it.
Just make it.
I mean, and the big thing, too, was obviously this. The thing we were happy about was that we really loved the episode we did, Woodland Critter Christmas. And the thing is, we really wanted to see those characters again, but we're like, yeah, but, you know, technically you can't because... In that episode, the Woodland Critter Christmas were made up by Cartman. It was just a book that he wrote. And so, really, you couldn't bring them back because they're imaginary. And so now we realize, wait a minute, we've got imaginary characters now. We can have the critters.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as we're like, oh, let's bring the critters back, then we knew, okay,
everything.
We've at least got another part here. We can make this three parts now.
As soon as the critters were in it, everything kind of came together.
And that's why it was pretty funny because what happened when the first episode aired, Comedy Central put in an ad that said, tune into the thrilling conclusion next week. And then everyone saw this episode and saw, wait, no, it's not, and everyone thought Comedy Central messed up, but actually we were the ones who told them it was only going to be a two-parter. And then we started making this episode and a lot of fun stuff was happening and stuff. We just wanted to keep it going and we liked where it was going. We liked how it ended. So we're like, no, let's go and tune in for three parts. So it was a big, It was a big challenge. It was a big 3 weeks because there's obviously a lot of stuff going on, but but it was fun.
Yeah, it was cool that it came in the middle of the season, too.
Yeah.
We thought about it. It was better, I think, because it broke up the season.
Yeah. All right, let's look at part three. I wonder what happens in that.
Time to pay up,
Imagination. So the first thing in part three was I wanted to figure out a different way to... I didn't want to just do another previously on because that's what it always is. And so we kind of struggled to come up with this way that we realized we could use something from the second Lord of the Rings where the guy is sitting there.
Yep.
Basically, this shot's from that movie.
He's kind of saying what happens. Yeah. Here's the setup for where we are, resetting the table for all this stuff.
And it was challenging. I mean, coming up with all... We had to just keep coming up with imaginary characters and trying to run the gamut, you know, not making them all animated characters and try to make some of them, you know, different countries and different live-action shows or whatever it was. So it was actually... We had to... And, you know, dolls and stuff like that. We just had to keep trying to come up with them. I like that little smurf in the back.
Yeah. It's as much Storyland, too, as Imaginationland.
Yeah.
Because really the central point of the whole kind of thing comes around to the power of story and how, you know, that we always like the idea that Jesus is just as important as Luke Skywalker, as just as important as a Smurf.
Yeah.
And, you know, they all kind of live here.
And as to the same, you know, when people ask if I believe in God and Jesus, I say yes, and I believe in Luke Skywalker and I believe in Santa Claus. And that this was the show that was really about that, because that's... Sort of the point is, like, those things are super big and important, and they all live together and fight evil.
And I believe in Al Gore.
That's probably good. We got to have Man Bear Pig back, which was nice, too, and actually see Man Bear Pig.
I think people were hankering for Man Bear Pig.
Everyone loves Man Bear Pig.
Fan favorite. That's probably good for Imaginationland.
Yes, we talked
so much about that.
This is Guitar Quiro, which we read an article somewhere that said that this was actually, what was it, like the number one product placement?
Yeah, it was like the best use of product placement. It was the most value in product placement or something for something. And it was in the New York Times, and it was like, how many millions of dollars worth of product placement Guitar Hero got from this episode?
Which is so funny, because of course we never contacted them or anything.
We never do anything. We've never, like, there's some kind, sometimes people, there. We've seen stuff on there because we've done a PS, you know, PSP episode, and we mention Xbox 360 sometimes, because, like, or Xbox, because, you know, and then we had the Wii thing with Cartman, and people talk about that we must sign some deal, or that's why, and that's actually not true. Now, we could, if we were smart, we would go get some money for all of this, but we don't.
We never have,
so people don't know what we're going to do, and... But there is a certain thing, just, like, you can't have a kid. Is it, like,
you can't do a story about
is,
a bunch of kids and not talk about Nintendos and
right.
Guitar
and
Hero.
And a kid is going to be excited about Wii
yeah.
and about Guitar Hero, you know.
Well, because we were excited about it, that's why.
Yeah. But anyway, just for the record, we don't get Dick any money for it.
Yeah.
We just put it in there.
But we did play a lot of Guitar Quiro to get ready for this episode, just to figure out exactly how it worked. This actually came, this scene right here came from the fact that it truly happened to Bruce. The sound producer, and he's this really awesome guitar player, and he was telling us that his kid and a bunch of his friends were over playing Guitar Hero, and that Bruce started jamming something really sweet, obviously, and the kids were like, "You're a fag, dude." Just like, that's not cool. And it's just,
so they started,
like,
playing the exact song they were playing with their little six buttons. He started playing for real, and they thought
it was gay. And I was like, that's sweet, that totally sounds like a South Park scene.
And by the way, your kids are right.
Yeah.
That's totally lame that you play guitar.
Try to score 60, he's not even listening.
Is he not listening? Oh, shit. I better be listening.
But anyway, this was another... it was just sort of a very basic idea. At first, we thought maybe it was a little too basic. But it ended up... It turned out really great because it had this great emotional story between Stan and Kyle.
We also had this joke in this episode where they go to a Colorado party. Like, basically, like, they get this big manager kind of wants to represent him. He takes him to this, like... big celebrity party, but it's all just Colorado celebrities. Is it Ron Zappolo in that?
Yeah, Ron Zappolo.
Ron Zappolo is this newscaster that when we were growing up in Denver, he did sports on Channel 4 in Denver, and now he's still in Denver doing, but he's more like graduated up to like reading the real news.
Yeah.
But he's like a Denver mainstay.
And Tom Shane, who has a diamond business, everyone knew. Oh, and that other, Jake Jabs, the
Jake,
furniture
Jake
guy.
Jabs, the furniture guy.
Like when you were a kid, you always saw Jake Jabs commercials, and you just...
Jake Jabs American Furniture Warehouse.
I wonder if that guy's dead.
No, he's still, I think I saw a commercial for him last time I was in Colorado. And he would always have a tiger.
Yeah.
So that was his
Or some stick. Animal, didn't
yeah,
he?
Yeah, he always had he was always sitting on one of his couches and he'd have an animal of some sort. That was his whole deal. And then we had Jay Cutler in that one too. But that was the joke, it was all the Colorado celebrities.
I think that's really it for Guitar Hero.
Okay, that's all. Move on. Rock stars.
So the list, it was sort of an idea we'd kicked around for a while too about Kyle being voted the ugliest kid in school and just how that would affect him. And again, it was just the very simplest idea, which always turned in sometimes with the best shows because you got a lot of room to just be funny. But we always like shows where it's just the kids being kids, and this has a lot of kids in it, and so we like that. And a lot of people love the shows where it's kids being kids, and so they always ask us, like, why don't you just do that all the time? I was like, well, because if we did that all the time, then you probably wouldn't like it anymore because we'd start doing lame versions of that and we'd run out of ideas and then we'd just be forcing it. So whenever we have an idea that's good, that's the kids, we're super stoked. And this, you know, this turned into a good... At first, it was just Kyle gets voted the ugliest and how does he react to that? And we knew that, you know, we'd have fun with how Cartman would react and how Butters might react not being the ugliest. But it was once we decided that... you know, that there's this whole other side to it where the girls, how they generated this list and what it meant, and that maybe there was some conspiracy going on about the list and that how girls take that so seriously and sort of this nice collision between the boys' world and the girls' world and that being the force that sort of brought Stan and Wendy back together. That's when we knew we had an episode.
There's a whole episode worth of stuff there. Also, the big joke that so does all the kids, I mean, look at Kyle. It's like they all look...
Yeah, they look exactly
like
same. How you say he's the ugliest.
We've talked about his big nose before, too. Yeah. Like, they don't even have noses. It's always stupid. But my girlfriend, this is her favorite. This is her favorite show. This might be kind of a girly little bit of a... This might be fun for the women.
Well, it's one they can really get because it's emotion. Being voted ugly, you know, is much more... Like, guys wouldn't really care so much about that.
Well, girls know how manipulative... I mean, girls can relate to being manipulative and making a little fucking list like that to screw with boys.
We spent a long time spinning because we wanted to do that little speech about Kyle kind of learning that, you know, it's the kids that are ugly now that are actually going to be someone interesting with character in the future. And it's pretty true. I mean, people that are hot are always cute or whatever, always handed things. And you can see that those are the people that turn out to be pretty lame. Even if they're still popular and successful, they're just kind of hollow inside. And we went through a lot of things going, who can tell Kyle that? And it got to be like Monday night. And we were still like, it doesn't make sense, you know, and it would have been the perfect thing for Chef, you know, because he was always the voice of that kind of reason. And we just finally couldn't get anyone. And someone finally in the room said, what about Abraham Lincoln? And we're just like, what? That makes no sense. And we just went with it. Yeah, and
apparently he was pretty ugly.
Yeah. I like Abraham Lincoln. Because it had to be a voice of authority, someone you would really listen to. And I think Abraham Lincoln is that person.
A voice you would trust.
So all in all, I think season 11 was pretty good. I think, you know, it had some ups and downs, but we saw it through, and so did you.
And now it's done. And these commentaries conclude all of our responsibilities for season 11 forever.
Right? And actually, they conclude as we're doing this. We just finished the first half of season 12. So these are the last words we're saying in the booth before we go out and just have some fun for a couple months.
So excited.
So thank you, everyone.
See you later.
Praise Christ.